The next stop is Avenue J.
The joke goes like this. It's the 1920s, and an American family takes their young son, and realizing that the opportunities for advanced learning are somewhat schwach here in the United States at that time, they ship him over to Eastern Europe and have him study in some of the great rabbinical seminaries there. And he spends 6 months there. He comes back to America. He visits with his parents, and they say, "Nu, what did you see?" And he says, "Oh, you know, it was amazing to me. I saw so many things. I saw people who believed so many different things than us. I saw a Jew who was an atheist, a Jew who was a Zionist, a Jew who was a communist, a Jew who was a socialist, a Jew who was an artist. I saw so many of these people." And the parents said, "So what's so surprising?" He says, "They were all the same person." Okay. In many ways, that does say a lot about who Rav Kook was, and as we shall see over the course of the next 50-odd minutes. I have a little bit of housekeeping to inform you of what's coming up for the next couple of weeks, so let's just go over that quickly. First of all, we are very grateful to our sponsors. As you probably know, if you've gotten the irritating emails, we believe very strongly that these lectures should be made available free to the community, both live here, and I'm very grateful for your presence here, but also on the internet, where they have actually a huge following, thank God. But the real point of doing this is that we want to support our students. So we have a fund for Jewish student scholarships here at Avenue J, and you know, we encourage people to sponsor lectures, which helps out the scholarships that I'd like to offer our brilliant students. So we have three sponsors for today's lecture. Mr. Paul Shaviv, who was expected here tonight. He's been a longtime follower of these lectures. He's stuck in traffic, but maybe we'll see him when he comes in and we'll embarrass him with a big round of applause or something. It's in memory of Dr. Yishai Shachar. We also are grateful to Ms. Sharon Byers, who has dedicated this lecture to Homer Byers. And finally, Ms. Pat Elvin, who is also a longtime follower of these lectures online. And one of the things I like about Ms. Elvin in particular is that many people, you know, watch the videos and then they like them, which is always nice. You know, you see the little likes appear on your screen and I get a little burst of oxytocin, which is a brain chemical that keeps us going back to Facebook time after time. But other people comment, that goes another level, and thirdly, people share. So she is one of those people who does all of those things, and she is sharing now in a material way by helping us produce these lectures and offer scholarships to students. So we're very grateful to all of our sponsors. The housekeeping that I have to announce is that next week we are not scheduled to meet. If you've gotten the handy little bookmarks, they work very well, by the way. I've tried them out. They work in books of all languages without any difficulty. I will be, thank God, I'll be a scholar in residence in Toronto next week in connection with the Shabbos Project. So we will not be meeting here in Brooklyn next Monday. We will pick up again the Monday afterwards when we have a fantastic topic. We're going to look at Emma Goldman, so-called Red Emma, who is labeled by the FBI as the most dangerous woman in America. And finally, for those of you who are in the Five Towns area, I have a small lecture series that's going to look at it's going to be a little bit more advanced, I think, in terms of the content, a little bit more sophisticated for people who have already spent a lot of time in these types of classes, looking at three rabbis who were criticized bitterly in their lifetimes, who later went on to create major influences in Jewish history as a whole. Specifically, we're looking at Maimonides, Rabbi Moshe Chaim Lutzato, and today we're looking at Rav Kook, so it overlaps there. Okay, that's it for the housekeeping. Why don't we go straight to the lecture itself then? So, Rav Kook, an incredibly important individual in 20th century thought. He is known, of course, most famously as the Ashkenazi chief rabbi of Israel, the first chief rabbi of Israel under the British mandate authorities, and he had a major influence on the political direction of the Israeli polity. He also had a major influence on the nature of Israeli thought and Jewish thought worldwide. As we shall see, it was a representation of a unique blend of Kabbalistic and Mitnagdic and Musardic trends within his one syncretic kind of worldview, which was really quite appealing and continues to have a lasting impact to this day. His years are 1865. He was born in the northern part of the Pale of Settlement. I'll show you a map shortly. And he died in Jerusalem in 1935. As I like to say, none of these lectures have anything original whatsoever in them. They are completely derivative. I've relied very heavily on two biographies. One is the rather amazing biography of Rav Kook by Yehuda Mirsky, which appeared in the Yale Jewish Live series. Definitely very worth reading. And I also had the pleasure of reading the scholarship of Jacob B. Agus, who a scholar from a previous generation who published a work on Rav Kook entitled Banner of Jerusalem in 1946. It's written in a very rich and evocative prose, which is characteristic of that era of scholars. People like Cecil Roth also wrote like him. And as far as I'm concerned, anyone who is publishing in Jewish history in 1946 is a hero into his own right. So I was very grateful to have the opportunity to see these somewhat different views of Rav Kook, but they have enriched my understanding and hopefully yours as well. So those are the basic sources for tonight. The rule is nobody is allowed to ask any hard questions, and I'll go straight to the material then. Okay, so Rav Kook was born in 1865 in the Russian Empire. This was an unusual and very special time, which ironically seems to have repeated itself in terms of the Weltanschauung, in terms of the Zeitgeist. Very good word. If you were undergraduates, I would write it on the word. Zeitgeist means the spirit of the times. It was characteristic of what Turgenev, the novelist, called the period of fathers and sons, the title of one of his most famous works, because there was an incredible gap between two generations in the 1880s in particular. This certainly affected the Jews, perhaps even more than it affected Russians, Ukrainians, Latvians, and so on. This was a period of tremendous technological change, but more significantly, social change, political change. There was a tremendous upheaval in the former Russian Empire at this time, as for the first time in literally centuries, sons were turning their backs on their father's way of lives, challenging them in so many different ways. To look at it from the non-Jewish perspective, this was the era when serfdom was seriously challenged. That is something that hadn't happened in almost 1,000 years. And one of the tsars in the middle of the 19th century had finally emancipated the serfs, although in many ways it was an emancipation that paralleled the emancipation of the slaves in America, which was not entirely successful for many reasons, but beyond our topic today. For the Jews, it represented, oh, and by the way, with the emancipation of the serfs came a lot of challenges to governmental authority, ultimately resulting, of course, in the abortive revolution of 1905 and the successful revolutions of 1917 that brought the Soviet Union to power. For Jews, it was even more significant because particularly in the under the impact of the 1881 pogroms that we discussed briefly last week when we talked about Jabotinsky, there was a tremendous challenge to rabbinic authority that sometimes expressed itself as a Zionist impulse, sometimes expressed itself as a socialist impulse, sometimes expressed itself as an assimilationist impulse that could be expressed either in the Russian Empire itself, as Jews chose to nominally convert to other faiths, particularly Christianity, or they chose to come to America and famously threw their tefillin overboard as they were approaching Ellis Island. So there are all of these tremendous challenges of fathers to sons. I would hazard a guess that many of us in this room are the descendants of those children who challenged their fathers, those who came particularly in the great wave between 1882 and 1928. And we are in many ways trying to pick up the pieces of that Kulturkampf that existed in the late 19th century. The reason why I mentioned earlier that it's kind of got a parallel in the 20th century is if you think of the hippie era, the 1960s and 1970s, the age of Aquarius, you know, the tremendous challenging of the technological and social revolution associated, for example, with the development of psychotropic drugs, the reliability of modern contraception created such tremendous social changes that were unheard of for generations prior, resulted in a very different society in the 1980s. Similarly, we have this happening in the time of Rav Kook's period in the late 19th century. Among the Jews, there are three basic Ur groups, three basic kind of rooted groups within the Russian Empire. These were the Hasidim, the Misnagdim, and the Maskilim. Just, I'm sure many of you are broadly familiar with these various groups, but let me take a minute to just give you thumbnail definitions of them so that we can all be on the same page. The Hasidim are primarily an 18th century phenomenon, a reform movement within Eastern European Judaism that rebelled against the rather, I'm looking for a fancy word for dry acerbic intellectualism of the northern regions, the Lithuanians. The Lithuanians, who were justly aghast at some of the innovations that the Hasidim had brought to the table of Judaism, opposed these reforms, and so they called themselves the Mitznagdim, the opponents. And they retreated within the four walls of Halacha, as understood by their great sage, the Vilna Gaon. Mitznagdim today, also known as Litvaks, because they tend to be associated with the area of Lithuania, are known for their brilliant minds, effervescent wit, very sharp sense of fashion. Right? But they had a really massive falling out. The Lithuanians and the Hasidim fought over 100 issues up until the beginning of the 19th century, when they realized that both groups were facing a much more serious challenge that was coming from Western Europe, and these are the so-called Maskilim, from the Hebrew word Haskalah, which is in turn a translation of the German term Aufklärung, or Enlightenment. And the Enlightenment, which emanates from northern Germany, the principal proponent, of course, is Moses Mendelssohn, argued that Jews should modernize. Jews should learn the vernacular of the country. Jews should adopt the dress of the surrounding society. And the Haskalah frequently descended into outright assimilation. The point of the Haskalah, particularly in the second generation, was to achieve political emancipation, particularly within Germany. And unfortunately, in many cases, that desire for political emancipation expressed itself in a rather slavish imitation of German norms in an attempt to try and buy cultural respectability. So the Hasidim and the Misnagdim struggled with the Maskilim. So while the Hasidim and the Misnagdim may have been arguing about, for example, the correct time to pray the morning prayer or the correct way to slaughter a cow, in the West, they were saying, well, why should we pray at all? Or why should we keep kosher at all? So they realized that they had to form a united front against the Maskilim. Nevertheless, the Haskalah did make very, very broad inroads into Eastern European society. And so you have these three major intellectual groups of Jews interacting, conflicting with each other, often over the same Shabbos table during this tremendous period of fathers and sons, the 1880s through the early part of the 20th century. This is the environment in which Rav Kook grew up. He was a brilliant scholar from his youth. He was known as Der Griever Ilui. The Ilui means like the enlightened one, or the genius is a translation of it. What is the shorish of the word Ilui? Anyone here know what the shorish, the root in Hebrew? Eloi, from Allah, meaning to raised up. Yeah, so the elevated one. He was on a very high level. He was also known, and I'm going to turn to someone perhaps who knows Yiddish better than I. He was known apparently as the Der Kasoker Eloi, the cross-eyed Eloi. I only saw that reference in one book, and I looked in my all the Yiddish dictionaries I could find. I never saw the word kasoker as the word for cross-eyed, so might be lost in translation. But at any rate, he was definitely called an Eloi because of his tremendous skill, primarily in Talmudic learning. He had, however, a quite impeccable Hasidic lineage as well. On his mother's side, she was descended from the Tzemach Tzedek, one of the most important of the Chabad rabbis, of which there were seven. And in fact, a very delightful story that I think is quite telling of his personality and the vector of his intellectual development. After the Tzemach Tzedek passed away, his personal artifacts were given out to many family members, and the Rav Kook's mother received a button from the Tzemach Tzedek's coat, his Shabbos cloak. And so she took that button and she sewed it to the top of his yarmulke. And in fact, he had a button from the Tzemach Tzedek at the top of his head that was perhaps always pulling him upward towards the supernal realms. He went through a fairly typical upbringing. At this time, very, very few young men actually got to study Talmud at an advanced level. They had a very basic system of tracking where, you know, it is remarkable that Jews did achieve quite a large degree of literacy. It's not as high as you would think. The 1897 census indicates that Jews were literate at a rate of about 60%. Which obviously dwarfed the Ukrainian and Polish peasantry and was actually superior to the nobility as well. But still, 60% literacy is a remarkably low rate compared to modern standards. At any rate, after about 4 or 5 years of mandatory education for boys and quite often for girls as well, decisions were made as to how far they would go. And most boys, by the time they were 10 or 11, it was already decided as shoin genug, that's enough learning for you. You know how to pronounce the prayers in Hebrew. You know how to follow along Chumash. Maybe you know some Rashi, so that's enough for you. Now you're going to work as a shoemaker or a dairyman and so on. And only the elite could really afford on an economic level to continue in higher education. And even that, it was at tremendous penury. Rav Kook fell into that class, and he moved from city to city, learning in smaller yeshivas. The great yeshivas were just beginning to form at this time, until he eventually did study at them. Often eating at different families' homes one day per week, with the kind of humiliations that go along with the lifestyle of a Talmid Chacham, of a Torah scholar. He was ultimately married to the daughter of a scholar, which did not, you know, improve his economic circumstances very much, but nevertheless, he did have a very happy life with her. And around age 22, it became clear that he simply could not continue studying full time. So he was advised by the Chafetz Chaim to take a rabbinic post, and he took several of these rabbinic posts dealing with the average issues of shtetl Jews. The major influences, by the way, this map, this is the Pale of Jewish Settlement. This is the region in which Jews were allowed to settle in 19th century Russian Empire. It was a kind of a compromise that was set up by Catherine II when she conquered this region. Up until this point, no Jews were allowed in Russia proper. As of 1479, there was a ban on Jews in Russia proper. But when Catherine conquered this region, she really didn't know what to do with this massive amount of Jews. So ultimately, she said, okay, fine, they can stay where they are. And she even expanded some regions down here towards the Black Sea. But otherwise, it was kind of like a massive ghetto by the end of the 19th century. Huge concentrations of Jews, primarily in middle-sized towns called shtetlach, or shtetl, the singular, and significant populations in the larger cities like Kiev. Even though they were technically outside of the Pale of Settlement, there were about 60,000 Jews living illegally in Kiev. They wanted to build a wall around Kiev, but there was a huge political fight whether or not a wall would... Nobody gets my jokes. Okay, so we'll just go on. Someone gets it. Thank you. All right, so anyways, they're living there. Now, the northern part here is traditional Mitnagdic territory, with the exception of the Chabad Hasidim, who also come from the north. They're called the Litvisher Hasidim in some circles. And Hasidism proper is more towards right bank Ukraine here, right bank of the Dnieper River, and into central Poland as well. He was educated at many of the greatest institutions of the time, most notably the yeshiva of Volozhin, shown here, which was one of the first major yeshivas of Eastern Europe. He studied under Naftali Tzvi Berlin, one of the most famous deans of that institution, and he was his personal talmid there. This was an institution where they maintained learning 24 hours a day. And literally 24 hours a day, they would have shifts to make sure that the word of Torah did not cease to resound from its walls. There's a famous story by one of his contemporaries that they happened to be the last few guys studying one night, and Rav Kook said to his friend, "Isn't it amazing that our voices are right now keeping the entire universe in existence?" You know, he imbibed these midrashim and lived them in a very real way. He also was associated with the Chafetz Chaim, I mentioned earlier, a very saintly figure, towering intellect who composed the modern-day code of Jewish law known as the Mishnah Berurah. Since I'm mentioning the Chafetz Chaim, I have to show you a very short clip that surfaced just last year, an actual video clip of the Chafetz Chaim, which is, I'm sure everyone's seen it, but we have to see it again because it is so amazing. At this point, it's supposed to start on its own, but it's not doing that. What if I push the little button here? Will that do it? Here we go. There he is. He's the small man in the middle there. And he's surrounded by his bodyguards watching out for paparazzi. And here is one of the bodyguards about to come up. Just when you're about to see the Chafetz Chaim, he covers up the face. Whoops. But that is a rather amazing glimpse of greatness. Okay, let's go to his politics, because it is his political expression, which is what is perhaps most well known about Rav Kook. For those of you who were here last week when we talked about Vladimir Jabotinsky, I apologize. I'm going to have to use a little bit of this screen again. For those of you who weren't, I would encourage you to go back and watch that video on the web. Just skip ahead until you see something like this, because I give you a little bit more of a sense of who lives where. But just to give you a thumbnail definition here, the Jewish political spectrum is considerably more complicated than the American. The American is basically right to left, with capitalist views on the right, socialist views on the left. American politics tend to be quite close to the center by comparison to Eastern European Jewish politics. But there's another really important axis for Jewish politics at the turn of the 20th century, and that is the question of doekheit, here-ness. To what degree does a political party advocate remaining in the diaspora, developing Jewish life in Russia, America, what have you, or does it advocate moving to Zion? So in last week's lecture, we looked at, you know, which political parties occupied which of the quadrants. But I cheated you a little bit last week because I didn't want to overwhelm you. It's actually more complicated. There's a third axis. Besides the X and the Y axis, there is a Z axis, or as they say in my homeland, a Z axis, that tracks the religious nature of the parties. So far, all of the parties that we talked about last week were fundamentally secular or even anti-religious, but now we have to discuss, like, obviously the religious Jews were the backbone of traditional society. They easily comprised the majority of Jews, depending on how you want to define religiosity. So what did they think politically? So there are two main parties that we should look at. The first one, and you have to imagine this line here is like the making this three-dimensional, right? It's the Z-axis out here. This refers to a party which was established in 1902 called the Mizrahi. This is the party with which Rav Kook's thought is ultimately most closely associated, although he himself was not the founder of Mizrahi and only maintained a kind of a tenuous formal relationship with the party. But what basically do the Mizrahi believe? They believe that, first of all, they are towards the right wing, because everything on this side of the y-axis is anti-religious. You know, the socialist parties following Marxist doctrine that religion is the opiate of the peoples, that religion is intended to keep people essentially numb to the realities of their life, to class consciousness, class struggle, and so on. So there's not going to be any religious parties over here on the left. Mizrahi, therefore, is on the right, not necessarily because they have necessarily an economic association with capitalism, but because they don't have a home at all on the left side. And Mizrahi essentially said that whatever political framework we set up, it must conform to two basic criteria. One is that it should be religious, or at least Judaism-friendly. And secondly, it should be in the land of Israel. The word Mizrach means east, and of course, Israel was to the east, and prayers are said to the east, and so on. So Mizrahi means eastward, like Kadima means both forward and eastward at the same time, or at least means forward, so to speak. So Mizrahi was a political party that advocated both Zionism and Orthodoxy at the same time. I should point out, by the way, that the denominational developments that occurred in Western Europe were virtually unheard of in Eastern Europe. In other words, the reform movement, known as the liberal movement, that had evolved in the early 19th century in Germany, had very, very tiny representation in the Russian Empire. A temple, for example, in Lvov, which would be modern-day Western Ukraine, Lviv, but and some representation in St. Petersburg, but basically no presence at all. The conservative movement, which was represented in the 1840s by a movement called Historical Positivist, had no representation whatsoever in Eastern Europe. If you were religious in Eastern Europe, it would be Orthodox. And if you wouldn't be caught dead in a synagogue, it would certainly be an Orthodox synagogue you would not be caught dead in. That was funny too, I thought. But the idea is that Eastern Europeans, they'd certainly adopted anti-religious attitudes, but they were not interested in any kind of compromise position, so to speak, like reform and conservative. They really were not options in Eastern Europe. So Mizrahi was an Orthodox party. That's basically synonymous with what they would have understood as a term for religion. Now, we can't just leave it there, because if you haven't spent much time in Eastern European or Jewish politics, this may come as a surprise, because it seems so universally accepted in the early 21st century. But the concept of Zionism was very hot and certainly not universally accepted, particularly by traditionalist Orthodox Jews. They eventually came to be find their political expression in a party called Agudas Yisrael, the band or the union of Israel, which was at its foundation, at very least, a non-Zionist party, and in some of its expressions, an anti-Zionist party. Why is this so? The reasons are complex, but there are basically two of them. The first reason is because all of the Zionists that were advocating Herzl's platform, for example, certainly Jabotinsky, Pohelei Tzion, all of these parties, were either non or anti-religious. They were, for the most part, highly secular. It's not until really you get to Begin in the 1970s that you find a Zionist leader who has any outward sympathies for traditional Orthodox Judaism. And so many of the traditionalist Orthodox looked at the Zionists as free thinkers, as apikorsim, heretics, and so on, and were wary of having any kind of association with them because they were such a secularizing movement. It's also important, I mean, we don't have time to go into it in great detail, but it's important to really think for a second, to realize, you know, because we're Jews and sometimes we tend to be ethnocentric about things, I don't know, we tend to view our own political movements, in my humble opinion, in isolation. But if you step back and you look at the Slavic nationalist movements of the 19th century, we are moving in lockstep with what virtually all the other non-titular nations of Eastern Europe are exploring. the Ukrainians, the Czechs, the Poles to a certain degree, Latvians, Estonians, all of them are exploring the idea of having an independent state of some form, self-determination, and they're working through their language issues, they're working through their self-definitions and so on, with the goal of creating their own nation states. And so Zionism was in many ways simply a Jewish iteration of what all the non-Jewish nations of the region were similarly doing. It seems strange because there are definitely some idiosyncrasies. I mean, Zionism is an amazing phenomenon that you have a people that is essentially stateless for 2,000 years, somehow regaining a country and a language. It's unheard of. It is, you know, I have to like sort of suspend my disbelief because as a historian, it would be hard to do anything but go straight to shul and to eat lots of kosher Chinese because it's such a phenomenal thing that the state of Israel was reestablished after such a long time. But nevertheless, it is basically following the same kind of motions of the other non-Jewish nationalist movements of the 19th century. And as a result, many of the traditionalist Orthodox are looking at this with tremendous suspicion and saying, why should we associate ourselves with these heretics? It's really not appropriate for us. On another level, on a theological level, and it's hard to say, by the way, which of these two reasons is really primary. But on a theological level, there's a question as to the very propriety of creating a state, a modern nation state in Israel, particularly if it's not a theocracy. Because for 2,000 years, the Jews had lived with a civic myth, meaning the myth, not the sense of the word myth in the sense of an untruth, but in the sense of a belief system that was self-ratifying, that the Jews were exiled from their land in the first century as punishment for their sins, gossip and bloodshed and so on, and they were forced to remain in exile to expiate the sin of that first century. They would only be allowed back when they had finally achieved kapara, achieved atonement, and under the leadership of a divinely appointed leader, the Mashiach, then they would be allowed to return to the land in peace. And that's the metaphor that Jews had taken deeply to heart and given them the strength to withstand persecution throughout two millennia. Because every time, you know, a pogrom would happen or there would be some kind of attack on Jews, it could be placed into this belief system that this is the punishment for our many sins, and it would actually serve to harden Jewish resolve. Kind of like, as I'm sure you know, the metaphor, why is it that Jews eat hard-boiled eggs on certain sad occasions? And the metaphor is because the longer you boil the egg, the harder it gets. And so Jews view themselves in this sense as actually toughening up with persecution. God forbid, we would rather like to take it easy for a while. But the idea is that Jews had endured exile and its tribulations, and the idea of simply wiping that away, and as it were, in a chutzpahdik way, with a sense of nerve and boldness and brashness to say to God, enough, that's a very challenging idea. And then to add insult to injury, to say not only is it enough, but we're not going to impose a state in Israel that is bounded by the laws of Torah, it's unheard of and very offensive to traditionalist-minded Jews. There were Jews, of course, for two millennia, it was always considered a very valuable thing and a very meritorious thing for a Jew to emigrate to Israel, to live in Israel, just walking four steps, Dalet Amos, in the land of Israel is considered a mitzvah, a commandment into itself. And there were movements like Chovev Etzion, for example, who tried to establish religiously observant settlements in Israel under these circumstances, and they did not meet with the opprobrium that the later Zionists did. But those two basic reasons, the idea of working with secular or even anti-religious non-Jews was difficult. And secondly, the idea of challenging God's will by forcing God's hand, so to speak, and demanding to live in the land of Israel, this was extremely difficult for Jews to take. So as a result, By 1912, notice how late it is, by the way, the first political party starts illegally in 1897, and then it's already 15 years later, the Agudat Yisrael comes along. The Agudat Yisrael essentially formed itself as a response to all the other mobilization of Jewish political opinion. The traditionalist Jews, as it were, said, wait a second, you know, the socialist Jews have a party, the Zionist Jews have several parties. We have to like organize ourselves because it could be that there will be some democratic form of government, which in fact happened, for example, in Poland, the establishment of the Sejm at the end of World War I. And so the Agudat Yisrael was a kind of a reluctant response saying we're going to start a political party as a result. So this party obviously was in huge opposition to the Mizrahi, even though they were on the same axis of religiosity, and that's one of the reasons why Rav Kook was so challenging. So what about his thought? What was Rav Kook's thought? This is, by the way, a photograph of him at one of his multiple religious rabbinic postings before he moved to Israel. He had several influences on his life. As I mentioned earlier, he was steeped in the Misnagdic tradition, which emphasized traditionalist study of the Talmud, the Code of Jewish Law, and other texts like that. But he was also highly influenced by the Musar movement. Just in a nutshell, the Musar movement was a 19th century movement founded by Rabbi Yisrael Lipkin of Salant that emphasized ethical self-analysis as a tool for personal growth, primarily through the study of classics such as the Masilat Yesharim, the Chovot HaLevavot, several other books like that. And in fact, although he never met Rabbi Yisrael Salanter, when the latter died, Rav Kook even observed the full Shiva mourning rituals that one observes for one's principal rabbi. But first and foremost, there's no question that Rav Kook was a mystic. He was deeply, deeply influenced by the Kabbalah and by the Hasidic interpretations of Kabbalah that had come to him through Chabad and other schools of thought. He was an unsystematic thinker and writer. He was very fond of kind of like writing in a frenzy, whatever thoughts appeared to him at that time. And he is really a very beautiful, lyrical writer in Hebrew. It's like poetry. But his writings tend to have a kind of like a journal-like feel to them. They feel like personal inward musings and meditations. And he often insisted, amazingly, on publishing the first draft of anything he wrote. Much to the dismay of his son, who was his principal editor, he was insisting on don't change a word, even the things that I later regretted saying, even the things that I took back, put it all out there. It's kind of like a stream of consciousness writing that it's really, really powerful, but it's difficult to kind of like systematize. Immanuel Kant, he was not. He didn't like move from step to step in a logical fashion. He tended to ride the wave of his thoughts in a very mystical fashion. It is possible that this connects with some of his basic Kabbalistic ideas of how one encounters the divine. And he was really a God-intoxicated person. Everything for him was really an association with the divine, an opportunity to encounter the divine, very much along the lines of the Arizal, Reb Chaim Vital of 16th century Tzfat, for example. He likened the approach of divine inspiration to the Shvirat HaKelim, the breaking of the vessels described in Lurianic Kabbalah, that is the period of stress, the Sturm und Drang associated with the inflow of prophetic insight. And that pain and anguish that immediately preceded a euphoric high of understanding some greater truth is expressed very vividly in his writings. To give you one example that's most relevant for us in this very brief presentation, he faced the dilemma that all mystics face, and that is dealing with the problem of theodicy. In a word, theodicy meaning the justice of God. It is very difficult for anyone who adheres to a monotheistic tradition to maintain three basic propositions. The first is that God is good. That one seems pretty easy on its own. Then you have to combine it with the second proposition, God is all-powerful. So far, seems pretty easy. Okay, we can handle a God that is good, a God that is all-powerful. But then what do you do with the third statement? There is evil. How is it possible for a God that is both good and all-powerful to tolerate evil? So at this point, you know, we have a myriad of philosophical answers. Every monotheist tradition is rife with this problem. But for the mystics, and especially for Rav Kook, he argued that essentially the problem lies, as most traditionalist Jews would think, in the last statement, there is evil. He would say there is really no such thing as evil intrinsically. There is just greater distance from God and closer distance to God. Meaning, the closer one got to God, the more obvious it was that everything is good. The further one goes away from God, the more confusing, the darker, the more difficult it is to understand God and to perceive those things as evil. By the way, I have no idea what I'm talking about right now. I'm just like sort of saying words. I'm trying not to think about what I'm saying because they're very difficult to appreciate. But at any rate, but this is definitely true in his expression of the idea. He found it very hard to criticize any Jewish thing, any Jewish person. He genuinely loved other Jews with an Ahavas Yisrael, a love of the Jewish people that was incredible. And so the idea of not working with secular Jews was completely incomprehensible to him. Here is another member of the tribe, a person with whom he has a shared familial relationship. And the person, look at how much good there is in him. He wants to go and live in the land of Israel, where just breathing the air is itself a mitzvah. How is it possible that he is not wholly good in every way? And so therefore, unlike the traditionalists who would shun such relationship, he embraced them. He saw all these people. I was just reading Mesillas Yesharim. He says, the Ramchal says that we have to orient ourselves to God like metal shavings do to a magnet. You ever see a bunch of metal shavings on the ground and you put a magnet down, they all immediately snap to attention? So he saw every other Jew as a point of light trying to get back to its source. And so for him, there was no division with the secular Jews. And he wrote a very important essay immediately prior to leaving Europe in which he argued that nationalism was a holy phenomenon. Very challenging idea, saying that the desire of these secular Jews, so far from the tradition, so far from traditional learning, who wanted to go back to Israel, who cares what kind of state they think they want to set up? This is obviously, for him, the beginning of the flowering of our redemption. Three very key words, you may have heard them, Reishit Tzmichat Geulatenu, the beginning of the flowering of our redemption, meaning that this is clearly the onset of the beginning of the Messianic era. This is a very controversial phrase. It is read out loud in many synagogues today. And in other synagogues, if you read it out loud, you'll be kicked out. It's because it is fraught with theological import. By saying Reishit Tzmichat Geulatenu with regards to the State of Israel, it's saying that the State of Israel is itself, the government of Israel, Bibi Netanyahu, is holy, and that it is all associated with the ultimate unfolding of the Messianic period. Many Jews are uncomfortable saying that, particularly when you look at some of the antics of the members of Knesset, and which, you know, make American politics look really normal. So the controversy over what to do with Israel, is Israel like a secular nationalist phenomenon, kechol hagoyim, like all the other nations? Or is it something, as Rav Kook would say, it's just an expression of the Jewish spirit yearning to come back to its homeland? So this is an example of his Kabbalistic influences translating themselves really into interpersonal relationships, and ultimately the personal becomes political. He also had a phenomenal attachment to the land of Israel itself, the physical dirt of Israel. Famous stories, for example, about how he once criticized an individual gently for casually ripping a leaf off a tree in Israel, saying, how could you possibly do that to a tree in Israel, and so on. But this is kind of like the the transition of his thought towards the end of the European period. But we have to get him to Israel because that's really where he's prominently focused. So what happened is, not surprisingly, in 1909, the Ilui from Grieve was invited to take a position in the port city of Yafo, or Jaffa. And he came with his young wife, and the two of them established themselves there and immediately found favor with the populations around Jaffa. Now, we should recall that Israel at this time had a very tiny Jewish population. There were the so-called the Old Yishuv, which is primarily Hungarian Jews living in Jerusalem who had emigrated there hundreds of years earlier and had established themselves quite often very heavily dependent on the largesse of European donors who were supporting them, various tzedakas that are still in existence today, concentrated on the older established path of holiness and self-improvement dictated by the study of the Talmud and other texts. And then, on the other hand, you had all of these young, intellectual, free-thinking kibbutzniks who are practicing free love, experimenting with social organizations. Even the family unit was challenged, and doing things that were completely unheard of in the old yishuv. But Rav Kook was amazingly able to bridge the gap to both communities. The former community he impressed initially, at any rate, because he was so obviously a master of the traditional texts, and his learning could not be assailed by any opponent. But for the kibbutzniks and so on, he was beloved because, first of all, he insisted on speaking in modern Hebrew, which he did, by the way, also in Europe. Even in Volozhin, he had a habit of speaking only in modern Hebrew while he was in the yeshiva, not speaking in Yiddish, the vernacular. And so his fluent and lyrical Hebrew impressed them with his commitment. We should remember, even we saw last week, Jabotinsky in his propaganda film was speaking in Yiddish. And that's one of the most staunch Zionists of the time, nevertheless resorted to the so-called Galut language, exile language, to communicate. So his, and furthermore, besides his Hebrew literacy, the fact that he clearly had such deep-seated love for these non-observant Jews immediately won over their favor as well. So when he was well poised to become a popular and populist leader of the Jews at the beginning of the 20th century. After some prodding and persuasion, he was eventually eventually was persuaded by the Mizrahi to go to one of the Zionist congresses in Europe, but it happened to be right on the eve of World War I, and because his passport was Russian, he was not allowed to return back to Israel during the First World War. He spent a significant amount of time in Switzerland, and then later in London, where he did some rabbinic functions, but primarily he worked on his writings. So some of his most creative writings were produced during that interregnum while he was in Europe. Here is a quick look at what Israel looked like politically right after World War I. Of course, the British came in, and they were given control of the land of Israel by the League of Nations, the precursor to the United Nations. The so-called Palestine and Transjordan were originally one territory. They were later divided. And when the British began to organize the new state under their own control in the Mandate period, it was clear that the accomplished Rav Kook would become a leading figure. Since the Sephardic population and the Ashkenazic population in Israel, there are many Jews, I've kind of skipped over them, I'm sorry, from North Africa and from Persia, places like that, that practice in many ways a different rite and followed slightly different traditions with regards legal rulings. So they had to establish two chief rabbis, the Ashkenazic and the Sephardic, and Rav Kook was an obvious choice for the chief rabbinate. Here's a very short film that shows him actually in 1921, meeting with some British dignitaries. There he is walking outside the door. And you can see behind him Rav Sonnenfeld, who we'll speak about momentarily, who represented the Eda Haredis. This was a more right-wing religious party or religious organization in Jerusalem representing the old Yishuv. Okay, so let's look at some of the controversies that surrounded his life, because he was certainly not a man without controversy. The first most difficult issue was the Shemitah crisis. So if you're familiar with the Bible, you'll know that one of the more complicated economic commandments in the Bible is the commandment of Shemitah, which means to let the land lie fallow 1 year and seven. And it's, I believe it's the Chatam Sofer who says this is clearly evidence of the divine origin of the Torah, because any basic economist would have a better way of doing this, right? If it was a human document, it would say, listen, everybody who lives in the south, you have Shemitah on the, there's good economic reasons to let the land lie fallow, let the nitrogen build up, things like that. You guys in the south do it on year one, you guys in the north do it in year two, and we'll just rotate the land, right? No. The whole land has to shut down all at once for one whole year. And that means that you can't plow during that year. You can't cultivate. You can't harvest normally. You can't sell the produce normally. It means essentially you have to shut down all the agriculture in the land of Israel for 1 year in seven. And that means, of course, the eighth year is horribly affected as well, because you haven't had a chance to sow new seed and so on. And it's a disaster. Actually, the Chasam Sofer, also a 19th century Hungarian rabbi, goes on to say that the fact that the Israel lasted as two commonwealths for over a millennium is another example of a divine proof for the sanctity of the Torah, because they somehow did it. How did they survive? Anyways, so this was not really much of a question for the last 2,000 years, because Jews had left the land. Jews were exiled from the land of Israel, and even those Jews who were living in Israel, the tiny remnant in places like Tzfat and Yerushalayim and Hebron and so on, for 1 year they could live on the charitable donations of European Jewry and other wealthy communities. But with modern Zionism, and especially its emphasis on the value of the return to the land that was so basic across the Zionist spectrum, that Jews had to return Dafka, specifically to farming, how could they deal with this economic challenge? So in 1899, a group of important rabbis had found a temporary solution, which they adopted with significant trepidation, and only as a temporary measure. In fact, is it 1899? It might have been 1889. I have to check that. I'm sorry. Might be a typo. They essentially said, look, the commandment is only on land owned by Jews in the state of Israel and farmed by Jews. It's not a state of Israel. It's in land owned by Jews and farmed by Jews. Non-Jews, if they happen to own a farm, may continue to farm as normal, and that produce may be consumed as normal. We also have a precedent for a temporary sale that we do very commonly on Passover, where many families will keep their leavened products, pasta, schnapps, things like that, and sell it to a non-Jew during the Passover holiday when they're forbidden to own it, and then they can purchase it back again, which is erroneously thought of as a legal fiction. It really isn't, because you do sell it. It's sold, it's gone. And if the non-Jew doesn't want to sell it back to you, it's his or hers. So these rabbis in the 19th century said, given the economic difficulties of the fledgling settlements, we will allow them to institute a heter mechira, the permission of sale, where they will actually sell their farms to non-Jews for 1 year. And so then it sort of magically becomes not Jewish anymore, because a non-Jew owes the land. And since it's not owned by a Jew, therefore Jews may work the land, sell the produce, and so on. It was definitely considered a very tenuous kind of psak, decision, and many Jews railed against it and felt that it was not a legitimate representation of the Torah values, so to speak. But the problem persisted every 7 years, and so many rabbis argued that it should be abandoned, but Rav Kook was placed under huge pressure to validate the Heter Mechira, and ultimately he did. He argued that the Heter Mechira was an appropriate albeit temporary, solution to the economic crisis of the Shemitah, and it remains even to this day a controversy. I happen to be studying in Kollel in Israel during a Shemitah year, and I remember just the incredibly complex things we had to do just to keep track of where we shopped, what we bought, what we did with the change we received from those stores, because like if we went to the Makolet down the corner and we picked up, you know, like a dozen eggs, which are not subject to Shemitah, because they're not, you know, grown from the ground, but that guy is also selling, I don't know, celery or something. What about the change that he's giving me back? That money may have been used to buy Shemitah products improperly. It was a whole, you know, a ganze geschichte, so to speak. So it remains a controversy even to the present day, where some Jews will, maybe I can tell you a funny story. This was 1993, the year of the Oslo Accords. You know, a lot of controversy over the peace plan in Israel and so on. And I went to one Shabbos table with my family, and our host said to me, "Wow, what a year to be in Israel, eh?" And I said, "Yeah, the Oslo Accords, really." He said, "No, I was talking about Shemitah." Then I went to another house a few weeks later, and some person said the same question, "What a year to be here." I said, "Oh yeah, Shemitah." He said, "No, I was talking about the Oslo Accords." Right? So Israel is like that, I think. At any rate, very controversial, because he took the lenient position on Shemitah that it continues to be controversial today. He also faced tremendous opposition from the party that we mentioned earlier, the Agudat Yisrael, which ironically, even though it was a non or perhaps even anti-Zionist party, that didn't stop it from being established in Israel. In fact, it has seats in the Knesset today. Obviously, after the Holocaust, many of these political calculations had to be reworked out. But they were extremely opposed to his soft ideas, what they perceived as soft ideas with regards secular education. He felt like nationalism was a holy force. He also felt there was a lot of elements in the Haskalah of general enlightenment, of understanding of the world as a whole, scientific knowledge and so on, that was entirely appropriate and consistent with Judaism. And he felt that that was a very appropriate way for children to be raised, having secular education as well. The Agudat Yisrael maintained a much stricter view, wanting to limit education to solely religious subjects. And as a result, he faced many challenges and criticisms. He tried to establish a kind of a midway point, an organization called Degel Yerushalayim, the flag of Jerusalem, but it was so totally wrapped up with his own personal charisma that when he passed away, there was no way for these organizations to continue. He also had quite strong words with Rav Yosef Chaim Sonnenfeld, who was the head of the Eda Charedis, the congregation of the tremblers. Chared means to shake, in the sense of to like be very sensitive and concerned to fulfill the will of God. It's based on a verse in the prophets. And contrary to popular belief, they actually respected each other tremendously, and they got along famously, as you can see in person, but they bitterly disagreed with each other on a whole host of issues. For example, because Rav Kook was both a religious and a political figure, he was a representative to the mandate authorities of the Jewish population, he had to be involved in the construction of municipal governing authorities. And he differed from Rav Sonnenfeld on things like, for example, should non-observant Jews be allowed to serve on municipal councils? Should women be allowed to serve on municipal councils? And he always argued for a more liberal, tolerant, open-minded approach to many of these issues, whereas the Eda Charedis wanted to try and hold the line with the traditionalist approach, and so they were frequently at each other's throats, figuratively. In reality, they had tremendous respect for each other. You can see even they're sitting in such a way that shows their friendship. He also, and again, you can see this is an expression of his personal understanding of the holiness of every Jew. It was a very, very controversial event when the Zionist, the left-wing Zionist, very prominent associated with Histadrut, Chaim Arlesorov, was assassinated. And here's a picture of him in 1933. There was a huge hue and cry because he was a very well-known leftist politician, and suspicion fell on several of Jabotinsky's followers in the Beitar movement, most notably this man here, Avraham Stavsky. He was arrested and tried on very, very limited evidence, but it was a capital crime. And Rav Kook was absolutely convinced that he was not guilty of this crime, and he exerted tremendous effort to defend him, even when it was a highly unpopular cause. In the end, Stavsky was acquitted, but it cost Rav Kook a lot of personal prestige to back such an unpopular cause. So I hope in the course of 60 minutes I've given you some sense, just a glimpse into the greatness of this individual. Really, you can get the most of Rav Kook by reading his works. And had we more time, I would have liked to have shared with you some of his writings. Even in English, they come across in extremely lyrical and transformative fashion. But I'm grateful very much for your indulgence and your attention. I'll remind you, we won't be meeting next week. We'll meet the week after. But if you're in the Five Towns a week from Wednesday, I'll have a lecture this series there. Thank you very much for coming. Hello, everyone. I hope you've been enjoying the new series of lectures that we put on this fall. We thought we'd do something nice for you because we really appreciate the feedback and the comments and things like that. So we had these bookmarks printed up. They are genuine Jewish History at Avenue J bookmarks. As you can see, I'll hold it up close to the camera. Life size, and they indicate all of the dates of the various lectures that we will be having. They work in books of all languages with equal facility, and we'd just like to share this with you. So please send me an email at abramson@turo.edu and give me your mailing address, and we will send one of these right out to you, and we hope you enjoy it in good health. Thank you very much.
Stand clear of the closing doors, please.